We have, I think, an excellent panel. I'm proud to say all MEI people to help us understand the thinking in Iran, in Turkey, in the Gulf, repercussions on Iraq and Syria, and help us get a handle on the very complex and unfolding repercussions and dynamics. I'm going to introduce our speakers briefly. They will speak in the order that that they are seated. They will make, you know, sort of initial remarks, and then I will engage them in a bit of Q&A, and then we will turn to a Q&A with you. To my immediate left is Alex Vatanka. Alex is a senior fellow at the Middle East Institute. He is Iranian of origin and covers Iran and Iran's foreign policy for us, writes regularly in American and international press and comments in the media as well. Before joining MEI, he was with Jane's Defense and was heading their Islamic Affairs department. So has a lot of experience and covers Iran very intensively. He will share with us some of his observations as how this has unfolded in Tehran among the different power blocks and opinion spectrums of opinion. To his left is Tom Lippman. Known, I'm sure, to most of you. He's a scholar with the Middle East Institute. He has had a long and illustrious career. He's an award-winning author and journalist, covered and written on Middle Eastern affairs and American foreign policy for several decades. He was also former bureau chief at the Washington Post and is well known in that capacity. He has a book coming out in early 2016 called Hero of the Crossing, How Anwar Sadat and the 1973 War Changed the World. And he will be sharing with us his views on how he sees the Gulf countries, Saudi Arabia and others, reacting to the deal vis-a-vis the U.S. and Iran. He will be followed by Dr. Gönül Tol. Gönül is the founder and director of the Center for Turkish Studies at the Middle East Institute. She's also an adjunct professor at George Washington University, lectures at the National Defense University. Many of you are familiar with her writing and appearances on writes in the Turkish press and in the international press, covers Turkish affairs, both domestic and in terms of its foreign policy. And we're very happy to have her with us. Help us understand the Turkish reaction, interests, policies in relation to this deal. To her left is Ambassador Robert Ford, also does not need introduction. He's currently a senior fellow with the Middle East Institute, but he has had a very long and illustrious career in the U.S. State Department, was the last U.S. ambassador, of course, to Syria. But before that, served as deputy ambassador in Iraq, senior political advisor to the U.S. ambassador also to Iraq, was ambassador to Algeria, deputy chief of mission in Bahrain, extensive experience in Iraq and Syria and in the Middle East in general. He received the Presidential Honor Award for his leadership of the embassy in Damascus and recognized in 2014 with the Secretary of State's Distinguished Service Award. And in 2012, he received the annual Profile in Courage Award from Boston's JFK Library for his defense of human rights in Syria. And he is a frequent writer, briefer, appears on the Hill, an advisor on issues relating to Syria and Iraq. And we're very happy to have him with us to walk us through his views of the possible repercussions of this. Alex, let me start with you. Let me start with trying to understand, helping the audience understand reactions in Tehran so far. What has been the spectrum of opinion, spectrum of reaction? How do you think this will impact Iranian politics, but more importantly, its foreign policy towards the region? Alex?
Well, thank you very much, Paul, and thank you all for coming. Paul, as we discussed this, I took note of the fact that you said 5 minutes and pretty much and no more. So what I'm going to give you now is a set of bullet points, and I hope we get to talk about the bullet points that might be of interest to you. But each of these bullet points are sort of aimed to give you a flavor of what's happening inside the Islamic Republic of Iran following this deal. So let me perhaps start with the most important bullet point that I put at the top of my list. Reformists, moderates, intellectuals, most of the Iranian media and public opinion is in favor of this deal. So when I hear President Obama, Freudian moment there, President Obama talk about hardliners, I actually have to sort of scratch my head and look hard to find those hardliners. That's my headline for you in terms of the overall landscape. The atmosphere in Iran has changed. Since this deal was signed, now you can criticize the deal. There's a big difference now if you compare it to before the deal being signed. Before the deal being signed, you couldn't really talk about the nuclear program. It was a taboo issue. Now the so-called hardliners, the few of them that exist and are very loud, are out there and criticizing the deal. But what they have done, perhaps what I wanted to do so, is open up the entire debate about the nuclear program. And if you look at the course of the last 13 years of us having to deal with this Iranian nuclear issue, this is probably at the peak moment where you actually have something that looks like a serious debate in Iran about the pros and cons of having a nuclear program. People are actually asking the question that we've avoided, so they have avoided as long as they have, what is actually the actual cost of this program? And nobody knows. But the fact that it's been debated publicly in Iran in itself tells you that things are changing. As I said, I don't see any credible hardliners that can do anything to stop this deal. What might happen is obviously the deal itself, as we move forward towards the implementation stages, will fall apart. But that's not something that you can expect the hardliners being party to. That's something that will come as a result of the likes of Zarif not being able to continue on the path of implementing this deal from the 14th of July. The Iranian Supreme Leader Ayatollah Khamenei has been vague, and I know there are press reports and analyses in the U.S. that talks about this vagueness and almost sort of assumes the vagueness means that he's opposed to it. I don't read it that way, and I think if you look at the course of this man's role as Iran's Supreme Leader, it's very rare that he comes out in favor of anything in sort of black and white terms. He keeps his options open. He wants to see how this thing unfolds. But if you listen to the people closest to him, people like Ali Akbar Velayati, who was a 17-year foreign minister veteran and chief foreign policy advisor today to Ayatollah Khamenei, he's out there in the media defending the deal. If you listen to people like Firouzabadi, a very personal friend of the Ayatollah Khamenei from the city of Mashhad, where they grew up as children, and he happens to be the joint chief of staff today, he's been out there defending the deal vigorously. So I listen to people around Khamenei, and I take into account that Khamenei, given his position in the Islamic Republic, is not going to be the type of person that you might have expected from Iranian politicians. It's not going to be Ahmadinejad. It's not going to be outspoken like that. That's not the guy's character. Let me say something about the Revolutionary Guards, because obviously they're the third key interest party in the Islamic Republic. If you put Rouhani and his team on one side, the Supreme Leader's office on one side, then the third pillar in the Islamic Republic are the Revolutionary Guards. They have not come out against this deal. What they are doing instead is to sort of come out there and give speeches where they say, you know, we had to make these tactical retreats as part of the negotiations, but the strategies is still in place. We're going to continue being on the path where we've been. Basically, what they're doing is they're keeping themselves relevant in an era that might soon be upon them where they might feel less relevant. Certainly, if you look at the Rouhani administration's key focus in terms of where Iran ought to go from here onwards, and I can give you names in the Q&A and we can talk about these individuals, but from his office to his oil minister to his foreign minister, there is a team in the Rouhani administration, most of whom are actually educated in the West. Most of whom have known each other going back to the 1980s. Most of whom have worked together in the Rafsanjani administration from 1989 to 97, and then again when Khatami came in from 97 to 2005. These are not people that just suddenly by accident showed up and are joining the party. There's a cohesive thinking on their part in terms of where they like to take the country, and I think that is their strength. That is their strength. So far, they've been able to go over to the Supreme Leader and say, look, you need to sign this deal. You need to sign a deal because without this deal, what's going to happen is the system is going to start unraveling from within. So what I call them the team with an economic master plan. And again, I don't want to use a cliche, but certainly they seem to have something like China in mind. Open up economically, and then we'll talk about political reform later. And obviously, Paul, what we're going to talk about is where does regional policy fit in within this equation? We've seen a lot of movement, obviously, on this front. We've seen the Europeans, the French foreign minister, first visit in, I believe, 13 years, the German minister of economy for the first time in 12 years going to Iran. The Italians have been there. I mean, there's a lot of movement that probably is going to be used by the Rouhani administration saying, look, when we talk, when we concede, we can go places. One thing I say about the Rouhani team, and again, if you listen to Javad Zarif, I spend my mornings going through all the Iranian press that all these names are just in my head, and I get sometimes get. But if you listen to the speech of Iranian Foreign Minister Javad Zarif last week in Tehran, he was pretty damn open about what he thinks they need to do. Bring economic stakeholders from the West, tie them in, tie their money in, tie their investments in, and therefore you're going to make this nuclear deal sustainable. But what they're saying is it's not about the guns of the IRGC. It's about how many big corporations are going to come in here, invest their money, going to go back to the capitals and speak good of us. That's the thinking. Whether that's going to obviously work out, that's a whole different matter. There are many obstacles in the way. Look, Khamenei, the supreme leader, he's okay with economic reform. And he's so far obviously had said nothing about these great headlines we're hearing from Tehran. For instance, to give you one example, $185 billion worth of investment up to in the next 5 years in Iranian oil and gas industry. I mean, that kind of investment brings you to world global economic mainstream in ways where you have to, deal with people that yesterday were your enemies. And Khamenei has not opposed any of these projects or ideas so far. What I think you need to watch out for is if I was an American analyst and I'm sitting there watching this, I want to know how are the people in the Rouhani administration going to square this thing about go back to the global economy and deal with the Western world with what Khamenei has stated clearly as one of his key legacy issues, what he calls resistance economy, which is to say we're not going to become dumping ground for Western or Chinese imports. We have to stand on our own feet and learn some of the lessons from the last 10 years or so of sanctions. So Rouhani is very cautious in what he says. They're not saying, let's just forget about everything we've done in terms of sustaining our economy at home. He's very careful. He says, we're all going to deal with the Europeans only when it makes sense from the point of view of resistance economy. And I make this point because this is key to understanding whether the Khamenei Supreme Leader's office is going to come against this plan at any point in the future. Rouhani, unlike Ahmadinejad, has been extremely careful to make sure the Supreme Leader, at least in his mind, is the one who's driving this thing forward. On the nuclear deal, that was what Rouhani wanted to happen, and I suspect the same thing's going to happen on this major economic plan they have to come back to the world economy. I've noted something here which I'm not going to get into, but perhaps in the Q&A we can talk about it because this is one of the key questions. What was Ayatollah Khamenei's intention for these nuclear negotiations for the last year? Was it to prevent war? Was it to remove sanctions? Or was it to make friends? And clearly, a lot of people in the United States have question marks about the latter. You look angry? No.
Not angry.
You're good. I'm going to
quick. We're under a deadline.
Okay, listen, I have so much more. So let me stop here, and then hopefully we can get to the other points later.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, and I'm sure people in the audience have a number of things they'd like to hear more about. Let me just quickly ask you, in the U.S. we're following the institutional process has to go through Congress, the veto and so on. Is there any institutional obstacles? When do we know that this is officially accepted on the Iranian side institutionally, and how does that happen?
Well, I mean, they can play it different ways. They can go out there and say the Majlis has approved this, the Iranian parliament has approved it, and then once the Congress rejects it, the Iranians have a stronger case to say, we've been dealing with the Americans for the last 2 years in good faith, and this is how they treat an agreement. So they're going to look like the good guys. That, I think, is one argument you could put forward out there. But we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that the Iranian parliament, in the context of the Islamic Republic of Iran, is not a key decision maker. If anything, it's used by the Supreme Leader's office to sort of control the atmosphere politically. How much of a hardline voice do I want to have in the system? And they can do that by, making sure the right candidates from their perspective get into the parliament. And that's one of the key issues to look out for. Iran's going to have parliamentary elections February of next year. So if you see a lot of the so-called Rouhanite people being rejected between now or at least in media, being dismissed by the media friendly to Ayatollah Khamenei, being dismissed, that is a sign to watch out for. That means Khamenei has gotten what he wanted. He got the nuclear deal, but he's not going to let Rouhani and his team go that much further. And one way of putting an obstacle in their path is make sure they don't get too many supporters in the Iranian parliament. As I said, the Iranian parliament is not a key actor in this. The nuclear negotiations are going to be verified by the Iranian Supreme National Security Council. The parliament, some members of the parliament are asking for a vote in this, but what they're doing is theater. Political theater. They just want to say, if the Americans can play games, we can play games. But I wouldn't take them seriously.
We're not used to political theater in the U.S. But you say so. Tom, let's turn to you. Obviously, across the pond, across the Gulf, the positions of the GCC in general, different GCC players maybe having different reactions. What's your reading of how Saudi Arabia and others have taken this agreement? How does it impact their relations with the U.S. and with Iran? Are there any nuclear arm race issues related to this? What are your thoughts on GCC reactions and actions?
Thank you, Paul. As I look out at this audience, I see so many old friends that tells me I have indeed been doing this too long. I want to start off, in all the years I've been going to, living in, writing about the Middle East, I recently learned a random fact that I want to start this discussion with by just leaving it with you. In Islam, Islamic law provides for a tax called the jizya, which is levied on non-believers in an Islamic community. I learned recently that one of his first acts upon consolidating his control over Arabia back in the early years of the 20th century by Abdulaziz was to levy the jizya on Shia. Attacks on non-believers. And to me, if you want to understand the collective Saudi attitude about Shia, that tells you what you need to know. It's a good starting point. Okay, so keep that in mind as we go through the rest of this discussion. Last fall, I attended two of these uniquely Washington events on consecutive days at other institutions. On the first day, the panelists were all current and former American officials from the State Department, the Defense Department, National Security Council. And basically all of them said the same thing. We, the United States, have a unshakable, no doubt about it, commitment to the security and protection of our friends in the Gulf. And you'll find it in all our doctrines, in the CENTCOM commander's posture statement, in whatever you want to read, the quadrennial defense review, all these documents that are churned out in Washington, this was the gospel according to us. And you would have thought at some point that we're talking about Israel in terms of the depth. This was General Dempsey saying, you can take this to the bank, which became a sort of famous pithy quote. The next day, I went to a different panel at which most of the participants were Arabs from the region. And it became apparent that they had heard all this. They had heard it over and over, and they didn't believe it. There was a fundamental cognitive dissonance between them and us over an issue that mattered and which we saw in different ways. Now, that was when Abdullah was still king of Saudi Arabia. And it was also when the Saudis and others in the Gulf were indeed apprehensive about the way things were going and the probable or the possible course of the discussions with Iran and what it was going to mean to them. So in my opinion, what's happened now is that the GCC members collectively, and Dr. Anthony, I'm waiting for you to shoot me down on this, the GCC countries collectively have decided to believe it. Whether they really do or not, well, you know, what they tell each other over cardamom coffee at 3 in the morning, over scotch at 3 in the morning, I don't know. And they're not going to tell me anyway. But beginning with Camp David, the Camp David GCC summit in May, you could see that the GCC leaders had made a collective decision that the Iran deal was going to be done. They were not going to do a full BB on this, okay? They need us more than we need them. And I think that's clear, especially because of the new realities in the oil market, but not only because of the new realities in the oil market. And there was the joint statement of all the participants, the six GCC countries and President Obama at Camp David, I guess in the second week of May, said, we all recognize that a well-crafted agreement with Iran could be beneficial to the security throughout the region. And that's why the statement that they issued at Doha, what, last week or recently when Secretary Kerry was there, was not a surprise. Now that the deal is done, they simply reiterated the position that they had taken, knowing it was going to be done. And I think now what it seems to me that what's happened is that the GCC countries have decided that that issue is behind them. So they're going to take the United States at its word to all these new security arrangements that we have committed ourselves to, of which the first manifestation was the Patriot sale to Saudi Arabia, which came out not long after Doha. And they are going to work with us as best they can and better with each other to try to confront some of the problems throughout the region. And how do we see this? Well, first of all, the Saudis are feeling much better, and they're the ones who matter the most. They're feeling much better about the situation in Yemen. I don't know whether they've really turned a corner, but that deadly destructive stalemate that followed the onset of the bombing campaign in March now seems to have been broken with the retaking of Aden and the big air base to the north, the return of President al-Hadi's vice president to Aden. Ships are in the port, and you can now see the possibility of, at the very least, finally getting back to the negotiating table in Yemen. You also see it in, I think, in a reinforced attitudes about Syria. I don't want to get into a turf war with Ambassador Ford here, but I don't think it was a coincidence that the foreign minister of Syria suddenly showed up in Oman. Right? You're all familiar with the link that Oman provides between the Gulf and Iran. I don't know what they said. Walid Mualim hasn't talked to me since he got mad at me when he was ambassador here in Washington 20 years ago. But all of a sudden, the air was full of airplanes going here and there. And you can see, I think what I would describe as a sort of collective waking up. The Iran agreement, for better or worse, is a done deal. Therefore, we have to look for other things. And we got a lot of problems, right? So let's work with the Americans and with each other to address these. Whether they can actually get their act together, I don't know, but they certainly are going to have the military equipment and capabilities to do what they think they need to do. And the American commitment, I just read this morning, while you were reading the Iranian press, I was reading a new piece by Tony Cordesman that pulls all this stuff together. Finally, let me just say, one of the arguments bandied about in the United States during the discussion about the Iran treaty, mostly raised by people who, in my opinion, don't fundamentally understand the Gulf or Saudi Arabia, was that the treaty would set off a nuclear arms race in the Gulf. I don't believe for one minute that that's true. And I've been writing this until people are bored with my writing it for more than a decade, and my reasoning hasn't changed. Yes, it's true that the GCC countries have a stated commitment, which some of them are acting on, to create nuclear power in their countries. There are two plants under construction in Abu Dhabi, and the Saudis have very ambitious plans, frankly, they need nuclear power, because the Saudis are burning as much as 30% of their own oil, because they burn crude oil in their electric power plants. They can't afford to go on doing that. But basically, I would raise this argument. You heard what my colleague Alex Vatanka was saying about the Iranian economy. In Saudi Arabia, which is the country that matters most on this subject and throughout the Gulf, the first guiding principle for the Al Saud rulers of Saudi Arabia is self-preservation. Preservation of the Saudi state. They have decided, recognized, I think, that they can't do that as a confrontational state in which they feed the people, they give the people bread and circuses and don't fulfill their aspirations for a better life. The House of Saud has committed itself to a future of full integration with the global economy. There's a reason why the biggest foreign investment plants, operations in Saudi Arabia last year that went online were those of Alcoa, Dow Chemical, and General Electric. Not to say nothing of the Mars Candy Company, which opened a big factory in Jeddah. They can't afford to be and don't want to be the North Korea of the Gulf. They understand perfectly well that their position as a full partner in the world economy and their commitment to surpass Germany as the world's leading exporter of petrochemicals cannot be fulfilled if there are nuclear outlaws, and therefore they won't do it. That's my opinion.
Thank you very much, Tom. Very excellent and concise presentation. We also came out with a phrase that I mean could be coined, doing a full BB. I like that. a new thing. Gönül, let's turn to Turkey. Obviously, there's a lot going on internally and on its borders, but focusing a bit on the nuclear deal with Iran, what's the spectrum of opinion there? How does the government see it? What are the pros and cons? How might it affect Turkish government policy?
Thank you, Paul. And Tom just mentioned that if you want to understand Saudis, you really have to understand their fear of Shiite. And if you want to understand Turkish politics, you have to understand Turkish fear of the Kurds. So from domestic politics to Turkey's foreign policy, that fear is the key to understanding Turkey's behavior. And I think it plays a part in Turkey's Iran policy as well. On the Iran nuclear deal, Turkey shares Western objectives on Iran nuclear program, but it has promoted a different, it has promoted engagement instead of isolation, and it has been against sanctions. And that's why in 2009 and 2010, back in the old days when Turkish foreign ministers zero problems with neighbors policy worked, Turkey wanted to play a bridge role between the West and Iran. So in 2010, Turkey voted against Iran sanctions at the United Nations. And yet, Turkey is happy about the Iran nuclear deal for two reasons. And the first reason is economic. Iran is a huge market for Turkey, Turkish goods and product. It's a preferential trade agreement with Iran. And it has close energy ties with Iran. So this is a big opportunity for Turkey. And Turkey has been mobilizing Turkish businessmen to start investing in Iran. So that's a big opportunity for Turkish business. But also Turkey has objected to a nuclear Iran, has traditionally objected to a nuclear Iran, arguing that could change the regional balance of power in favor of Iran. So that's been Turkey's policy, and that's why all political parties, from the ruling party to the opposition parties, NGOs and business organizations, pretty much everyone in Turkey is quite happy about the nuclear deal and the lifting of sanctions. But Turkey has strategic concerns about Iran. It has three strategic concerns. And the first one is the rising influence, Iran's rising influence in Syria and in Iraq. Turkey has always argued that the stronger Iran is, it will have more power and it will step up its support for the Shia militias in Iraq, which is a destabilizing factor in Iraqi politics. So that's why Turkey has been against Iranian influence in Iran. And similarly, in Syria, they are on opposing fronts, and Iran's rising influence in Syria is undercutting Turkey's policies in Syria. And the second concern, strategic concern Turkey has, is closer ties between Washington and Iran at the expense of Turkey. Turkey and Washington, they haven't been on the same page in Syria. They've had conflicting priorities and objectives in Syria. And Turkey has been quite upset with Obama administration's policy in Iraq as well. So Turkey thinks that if Washington and Tehran, they cultivate closer ties after this, because of this nuclear deal, then they could they could undercut Turkey's Syria policy. Mainly, Turkey has been supporting the toppling of the Assad regime from the get-go. Since the uprising started in March 2011, Turkey has been, late August, in fact, August 2011, Turkey has been supporting the Syrian opposition. And Turkey has become an operational hub for the Syrian opposition. And Turkey has invested heavily in the anti-Assad coalition. So that's Turkey's strategic number one aim in Syria. And yet, the United States has seen the Islamic State as a bigger threat. So that's why there's been a lot of tension between Washington and Ankara. Ankara is upset that Turkey is not fully on board on the anti-Islamic State coalition. And until very recently, Turkey has refused to open the U.S. Incirlik Air Base in Turkey for coalition airstrikes against the Islamic State. And the U.S. and other Western allies have complained that Turkey has not done enough to stop the crossings of foreign jihadis using Turkish territory. So there's been a mismatch, and the two countries, they have not seen eye to eye on Syria. So now Turkey fears that Washington and Iran could cut a deal in Syria. And that's why, although welcoming the Iran nuclear deal, Turkey has been trying to mend fences with the U.S., thinking that it could also join the newly emerging front. And the third concern that Turkey has, strategic concern, is Iran's support for the PKK and the PYD, PKK's offshoot in Syria. And that's not a new concern for Turkey. For decades, in the 1990s, Turkey had zero relations almost with Iran, strategic relations, because Turkey has always feared that Iran was supporting the PKK and the Kurds to destabilize Turkey. And after the Syrian conflict started, the Kurdish issue has become another vulnerability for Turkey, because the Assad regime supported the Kurds in the north, gave a free hand to the PKK, allowed the PKK leadership to return to the country. And so the PKK issue has become more complicated for Turkey because of the Syrian conflict. And more recently, there has been a ceasefire since 2013 between Turkey and the PKK. But more recently, the two sides resumed violence. And now Turkey fears that Iran could play the PKK card, the Kurdish card again. And Turkish media last week reported that Iran approached the PYD and the Kurds, and promising them support, as much support that it has provided to the Assad regime, if they join the fight on the side of the Assad regime. And this is a huge concern for Turkey, and I think that's one of the reasons behind Turkey's recent attacks against the PKK. So in response to those three strategic threats and concerns, Turkey has done several things. Turkey-Saudi ties has been tense under the old king, but after he died, Turkey kind of launched this rapprochement with the Saudis in an effort to counter rising Iran influence in the region. And also, Turkey, Saudi, and Qatar, Turkey has been pursuing a very aggressive Syria policy since 2014. Saudis, Qataris, and the Turks, they've been supporting groups like radical Islamic groups like Ahrar al-Sham and al-Nusra Front in Syria. And I think that is also partly in response to, it's an effort to counter the Iran influence in Syria. And recently, Turkey opened the Incirlik Air Base for coalition airstrikes against the Islamic State. And the main reason was not the Iran nuclear deal, obviously. There was an attack by Islamic State that killed 32 people, Kurdish activists. So that was a turning point. But I think part of the reason was Turkey really wants to mend ties with Washington. So I think Turkey has taken these several steps, but still, I think when it comes to Iran, Turkey and Iran, they've had peaceful relations for almost for centuries, since 1639. So Turkey, on the one hand, is very concerned about the rising Iran influence, but on the other hand, I don't think it is willing to completely alienate Iran. That's been Turkey's policy. And it could be able to, Ankara could be able to compartmentalize its relations with Iran. On the one hand, they have very close relations economically and very close energy ties. On the other hand, despite their differing stances in Syria and in Iraq, they could be able to manage to have a working relationship. And I think it will remain so.
Thank you very much, Gönül. A fascinating, very detailed presentation. Thanks for that. Let me turn to Ambassador Ford. Impacts on the long-running conflicts in Syria and Iraq.
Thank you, Paul. It's very nice to be here. Thank you for the invitation. They said, well, when you speak for 5-6 minutes on how this is going to affect Syria and Iraq. And I thought, 5 minutes. So it reminded me of a story of a very ponderous British archaeologist who was invited at the end of the 1900s, beginning of the 20th century, to give a talk about his archaeological research in the Far East. And he'd been digging up temples and deep in the jungles and ancient cities. And the British Museum asked him to come and give a talk for 20 minutes. And he spluttered to his friend, the British playwright Oscar Wilde, and said, how can I possibly explain everything I know in a mere 20 minutes? And Oscar Wilde told him, well, speak slowly. So I just tell you that story, I've used up a minute, so I only have four to go. Just on Syria and Iraq. Washington is consumed with the issues of this nuclear deal and the politics. The problems in Syria and Iraq actually don't evolve really around Iran or the United States. The problems in Iraq and Syria involve grievances among communities that are longstanding, predate this nuclear accord, and they're going to go on well beyond it. I think a bigger question would be, is there a prospect, a reasonable prospect, of greater American-Iranian cooperation in these two conflict zones? And so let me look at that a little more deeply for just a couple of minutes. On the Iraq side, when I think of this war against the Islamic State, I think of it as a two-front war. There's an Eastern Front, and a Western Front. So on the Eastern Front in Iraq, first, the pressures on the unity of the Iraqi state are growing exponentially now. Low oil prices are pushing the Kurds more and more to seek independence because they're not getting the payments they were promised from Baghdad. It's just one more Kurdish grievance among others. And there is not much progress, let's be honest, there's not much progress so far on reconciliation between Iraq's Sunni Arabs and Iraq's political Shia, the ones who are basically in control in Baghdad. The Iranians are part of this, although they are not the most important part. They have close allies among Iraq's political Shia, and they are particularly close to several very capable and potent militias, some of which are on the American terrorist designated organizations list, groups like Kata'ib Hezbollah and Sa'ib al-Halaq, who killed hundreds of American servicemen during our military presence in combat there. I don't think the Iranians are likely to give up those allies. And those allies themselves, these Shia militia, other political Shia, have big political ambitions. They still do. In fact, if you're watching the news, the Iranian-backed Shia militia leaders are actually now calling on their members to join the demonstrations that have been taking place in Baghdad and other cities in recent days, protesting the poor provision of services such as electricity and water. These political militia leaders, people like Hadi al-Amri and Qais Khuzali, are extremely agile. They're very capable. They're very smart. They're very ruthless. They're very capable. in the absence of reconciliation between, on the one hand, these Shia militias and the Sunni Arabs on the other side, it's not clear that the Americans and the Iranians are going to be able to work a whole lot on the Islamic State problem in Syria, because the Islamic State, the Islamic State problem in Iraq, because that problem is basically a problem that the Islamic State recruits to replace its losses. And as long as that political entity is marked by lack of conciliation, distrust among Sunni Arabs, the Islamic State will be able to recruit, replace the losses, and the fight goes on. If the Americans saddle up too closely to the Iranian-backed militias, they will actually help the Islamic State recruit more people. I think the administration is very aware of this. So they've been very careful to hold these Shia militia at length. The Americans actually refused to provide air cover, close combat air support, when these Shia militias attacked the Sunni Arab, predominantly Sunni Arab city of Tikrit in the spring, which, in my opinion, was a very smart move. So how they will cooperate with these Iranian allies on the ground in Iraq in the future is not clear yet. Only if the Iranians are willing to cede authority of these militias to the Baghdad government of Prime Minister Abadi, I think, would we then have a greater margin of maneuver with the Iranians in Iraq. That's the good news. The bad news in Syria is that the war is no longer really a stalemate. Actually, the Assad regime is now clearly losing. I was just talking to Gunel and Tom before we started. The Syrian armed opposition is actually closing in on the Alawi homeland. They bombarded Assad's hometown of Kardaha a few days ago. That's how close they're getting. But there is no sign, that the Iranians are backing off their support for the Assad regime in Syria. Just last week, the Iranian foreign minister was visiting Kuwait and Qatar, and in Kuwait, he said, promised that Iran would stand by its friends in the region, clearly indicating Syria among them, and then took a shot at the Saudis and said it is up to other countries in the region and here in the Gulf to change their policies that are destabilizing. There is, however, some diplomatic frequent flyer mileage being expended right now, with visits being traded between the Iranians, the Russians, and the Saudis. And even there's a report, not confirmed, that one of the most important Syrian secret intelligence service officials visited Saudi Arabia last week, which would be a remarkable visit if it in fact occurred. It hasn't been confirmed. There are reports that the Iranians are about to put forward a peace proposal for Syria, which would include a call for a new national unity government. It would include a change to the constitution of Syria to better protect the rights of Syrian minority communities. And it would include a promise of free elections under international supervision at some point in the future in Syria. And the Syrian foreign minister visited Tehran last week and then went to Oman, presumably to talk to the Omanis and through them to the Saudis about this proposal. The Russians sent their deputy foreign minister Bogdanov to be in Tehran when the Syrian foreign minister was there. So there's clearly coordination between the Russians, the Iranians, and the Syrians. I don't think this is going to go very far, in part because of what Gunel was just saying. The Turks so far are not signed into this, although I noticed that Zarif is about to visit Ankara to talk to the Turkish foreign minister, Çavuşoğlu, and I'm sure this will be on his agenda. The Turks have a veto in all of this because of their support to the armed opposition in the north, and I have to say, based on my many discussions with the armed opposition, I cannot imagine they will, A, trust the Iranians, and B, even if they did, they would never accept that Bashar al-Assad stay on as part of a transition government, which I think is what the Iranians are talking about. So in Syria, is there scope for the Americans to work with the Iranians against the Islamic State? Well, the Russians and the Iranians are both urging the Americans to stop pushing against Assad and instead work with him. But remember what I said at the beginning when I talked about Syria. The Assad regime is now losing. Its army is starting to withdraw. Their supply lines to Aleppo are about to be cut. The Alawi homeland itself is about to be under attack. Last Saturday night, there were anti-Assad demonstrations in Assad's home province of Latakia, anti-Assad demonstrations in his own home base. Think about that for a minute. Is there then much space for the Americans to work with Assad? If Assad cannot retake the suburbs of Damascus after 3 years, what are the prospects of Assad being able to take on strongholds of the Islamic State in places like Raqqa and Deir ez-Zor, which are 300, 400, 500 miles from Damascus? Instead, it seems that there would be a bigger question about some kind of diplomatic coordination with the Iranians. But that, in turn, will require the Iranians to accept that the Assad regime is actually now losing the war and that there has to be a transition to move Assad out. I think will not be possible to bring Turkey along, probably even the Saudis along, without the Iranians making that concession. Not clear when the Iranians are about to get a large amount of cash as part of sanctions relief over the next 16 months, that they're going to be willing to make that concession, but I leave that to Alex to make that conclusion. But in short, longstanding grievances and events on the ground don't suggest an immediate change for American-Iranian effective collaboration against the Islamic State in Syria or Iraq. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you very much, Robert. Thank you for that. Let me come back to each of the panelists with one quick question each and then turn it over to the audience. And let me go back to you, Alex. You gave us a very excellent view of sort of the big picture of how things are being viewed in Tehran. If you dial down a bit and, you know, tune us into the conversations, the statements relating to their regional partners. What's the spectrum of opinion relating to Iran's relations to Saudi Arabia, and particularly in the Gulf states? Is there any new language? Are there any new proposals? I know the foreign minister has made a number of those, but more on the hardline side, is there any vision that this deal might signal a new era? And with relation to Turkey, obviously they have a longer history of economic cooperation, but bitter difference over Syria. Are you seeing any new language that relates to their regional partners, anything that can be built on realistically?
Thank you, Paul. Let me just go back to last week, just to give you a flavor of the contradictions that you hear come out of Tehran, which frankly doesn't help the Iranians in terms of making friends or convincing anyone. So we had, on the one hand, the Deputy Foreign Minister, Abdullahian, talk about, you know, we need to talk to Saudi Arabia, specifically talking about Yemen, but elsewhere also, in his case, talked about the situation in Bahrain. But then we have Ayatollah Khashoggi on Friday prayer talking in the sort of strongest language you can imagine, putting Saudi Arabia, Israel, and ISIS in the same category and saying United States backing all three. And you sort of sit there and scratch your head and say, well, you know, if you're really trying to make new friends and you've decided that you want to walk away from the past bad ways, this is not going to convince anyone. I mean, you're going to leave many people around the world, particularly certainly here in Washington, with that question. Should I take someone like Zarif or Rouhani seriously? Which has been the question that we've all had for the last 2 years. Are these people actually going to make a difference? Are they just being used by Khamenei for the purposes of removing the sanctions? But then once that is done, then the fears of the skeptics of the deal will sort of live itself out. I see certainly division in terms of the thinkings in Tehran, Paul. You have the people, I mentioned some of them, who, let me give you a specific example, Oil Minister Bijan Zanganeh. Bijan Zanganeh is key in Rouhani's cabinet because the Iranian economy depends on that oil revenue and in the future more so on natural gas. So he's got a key task. If you want to maintain the economy, if you want to continue to have a degree of political stability, you better do something with the economy. So Zanganeh has that job. He obviously, in close cooperation with Rouhani, the president, was, you know, successful in getting a nuclear deal. Fine. Zangin has been very successful in reaching out to Europeans. Fine. Now there's another issue for him, particularly as oil minister, he needs to deal with, which is how does Iran come back to the world energy markets? I mean, this is a country with 18% of the world's natural gas, but barely exports any. This is a country with 9% of the world's oil. Today, produces, exports a third what it did a few years ago. There's a lot of catching up to do. And in the case of Zangane, in the context of the GCC, there's the elephant in the room is Saudi Arabia. So I can see the thinking on the part of the so-called moderates, the pragmatic forces from the Rouhani side of the equation in the Islamic Republic. But as soon as they play this card, if they played carefully and with some skill, they might go places. But if they're not, then they're going to be basically hearing the same argument that the Rouhani people have been hearing the last 2 years, which is, are you being quietly supported by the Saudis? How on earth can you argue for us dealing with the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, a country that basically says all Shia have to die? What are you thinking? I mean, that is the counter-argument that the Rouhanis of this world are going to hear from the IRGC people. But that only happens if the fight within the Islamic Republic becomes one where they're going to be desperately looking for ammunition to hit one another. And I can give you one scenario, Paul, and I round up with that. If President Rouhani doesn't play this post-sanction period in a smart way, because remember, the potential big losers of this deal are the IRGC and the many 800 affiliated subsidiaries that are part of the IRGC world and have been making money in Iran. Suddenly, those 11,000 contracts they got from the Ahmadinejad period might no longer be on the table for them. So they are fearful, not just in terms of ideology and so, they're fearful about whether they're going to get hit there in their pockets. And if Rouhani can play that game masterfully and say, look, we're going to bring the foreign firms in, but that doesn't mean you're going to lose out. And that's exactly the message you're hearing from Zangane and the like. So I don't know if they're going to play it, but when we talk about the region, specifically Saudi Arabia, because whether we like it or not, that is the giant that Iran has to deal with first and foremost. And incidentally, the only country Rouhani mentioned by name 2 years ago. Now the nuclear deal is in the bag. Can he? Does he think politically he's able to pick this issue up? It's a very contentious issue, Saudi Arabia. But perhaps he feels he's got what it takes to go forward. There's a lot at stake. There's no doubt about it.
Thank you. Tom, if I may ask you a bit about sort of the dynamics within the GCC. If just about a year ago, Qatar was isolated. There was a lot of internal politics in the GCC. Obviously, we have new leadership in Saudi Arabia and Qatar and Turkey cooperating very much. A number of GCC states have a lot of economic interest now and potentially with a sanctions-free Iran, so there might be dynamics there. To what degree do you see the GCC being somewhat cohesive in this coming period? Does that make a difference? How is it playing as a group?
The short answer is I see them being cohesive rhetorically, but not in terms of actual policy. Keep in mind, the only thing more tedious than wading through the Iranian press is going back and reading the charter of the GCC, which I've done. The GCC, the words defense, military, and security do not appear in the charter of the GCC. It was an economic and quasi-political organization from the beginning, and there have been various attempts over the years to hang sort of military doodads on this structure. And you may recall, Paul, you should remember this, that sometime, I guess it was late last year, there was yet another announcement that the GCC was going to form a unified military command, right? There may be people in this room who know more about that than I do, but if that military command has shown any signs of actually coming into existence, I haven't seen any. And the GCC countries do not have, and never have had all along, unanimity of views about Iran. The split between the UAE and Saudi Arabia with Qatar was not about Iran. That was about the Muslim Brotherhood, mostly, and Egypt. And I think they've managed to paper that over. It was Doha, it was the foreign minister of Qatar that did the talking for the group in Doha. And I think they're sort of being forced into accepting at long last this kind of American superimposed military superstructure in which they have to hang together or they'll all hang separately, so to speak. But it's true that even in the darkest days of the relations between the outside world and Iran, you could go to Dubai and sit at a cafe on Dubai Creek and look across and watch the Bank Melli Iran functioning over there in broad daylight. You can go out on the Gulf and you can see that somebody gets a phone call when the Iranian customs officials go home for the night and all these boats gun it from the Omani side of the strait and they all go over to sell their smuggled goods in Iran. There's a lot of back and forth in economic activity historically as well as actually. One last word on this. There's no unanimity within the GCC about each other. Don't get the Saudis started on the subject of Kuwait and its parliament. Right? And that's just one example. So they're going to hold their noses to deal with each other and what they have to do for self-preservation. That's not the same as being kindred spirits, in my opinion.
Thank you very much. Gönül, Turkey is at a time of particular political change. President Erdogan's plans for, you know, changing the constitution didn't work out. The Kurds did very well. And yet all of these issues also are very much at play. How do you see not just the deal, but much of what you talked about, how do you see that impacting the domestic politics, which soon will also determine sort of the new power structure, the role of the Kurds, Erdogan's new vision after his old vision sort of hasn't really panned out? How do you see that impacting Turkey?
Well, I think the Syrian conflict, and I've said this many times, the Syrian conflict, I think it was in 2012 when Charlie Rose interviewed Erdogan. So in that interview, he said Syria is not a foreign policy matter for us. And it was misinterpreted. Many thought that, oh, this is a neo-Ottoman way of seeing the region. But in fact, what he meant was Syria is a unique place in Turkey's domestic politics, and mainly because of the Kurdish issue. So yes, Syria is not a matter of foreign policy. We have now 2 million Syrian refugees, but aside from that, the Kurdish communities living on different, both sides of the border, they're organically linked, there are family ties, and whatever happens, and reportedly one-third of the PKK membership is of Syrian origin. So whatever happens in Syria has a direct impact on Turkey's domestic politics and Turkey's Kurdish policy. So that's why when there are these reports that in Sulaymaniyah in northern Iraq, there was a meeting between Iran and the PUK, Talabani's party, and the PYD leadership in Syria, that is alarming for Turkey. Because Turkey thinks that Iran and Syria, they have used the PKK card for a long time, and that destabilized Turkey, that changed Turkey's, that was the main driver of Turkey's Middle East policy. So now the PKK card is again there to be used by Iran and Syria. So I think this, in a way, Iran PYD rapprochement within the Syrian context is alarming for Turkey. And recently, I believe it was a military Iranian military official who was very critical of Turkey's bombing of the PKK targets. So this all confirms in Turkish minds that Iran is going to abuse and use the PKK card. So that translates into a very aggressive domestic Kurdish policy. And of course, for Erdogan, they're more at stake now by using the PKK card, by pounding PKK targets in northern Iraq, by arresting hundreds and thousands of PKK members domestically when he's talking about fighting against the Islamic State, but targeting the PKK mostly. That is all part of his domestic calculations. He wants to appeal to the nationalist card. So, but regionally, I think that is a response to what is happening mostly in Syria and Iraq. So domestically, what kind of impact will it have on Erdogan's domestic calculations? I think he's playing a risky game. He is it's a great thing that he finally opened the Incirlik Air Base, and he seems to be fully on board on the coalition against the Islamic State. And yet he still sees the Kurds as a bigger threat. So domestically, he's appealing to the nationalist votes, but on the other hand, this is risky because it could cost him the remaining Kurdish votes. So far, it seems that the him targeting the PKK is working in his advantage. But if there is an Islamic State bombing in a Turkish resort in the Mediterranean, that is really going to weaken the AKP. And I think that could really weaken his prospects of forming a majority government or calling for early elections or succeeding in capturing more votes in potential elections.
Thank you, Gönül. Robert, I know you resigned from the government for many good reasons. Let's say you were back for a week and had to advise Kerry or the president. I mean, there's been a big diplomatic achievement with Iran that's somewhat large and historic. You were involved in Geneva 1 and Geneva 2. If Secretary Kerry had to put on the table a roadmap for the remaining year and a half for this administration and make efforts on the Syrian crisis diplomatically, what advice would you give? An attempt to revive Geneva 2? Is the processes all completely dead? Are there any possibilities of cooperation with Russia on anything? Is there any light that you might see?
Geneva 2 ended in a hurry because the Syrian regime wasn't willing to negotiate anything. The Syrian opposition actually put forward in writing a year and a half ago to the United Nations Special Envoy at the time, Lakhdar Brahimi. They put forward a proposal in writing that they would negotiate a national unity government, and even Bashar al-Assad's future was subject to negotiation, that they did not have as a precondition. Let me say that again. They did not have as a precondition that Assad stepped down. That was a year and a half ago. At this point, so much has changed on the ground, and so much more blood has been shed. And my own sense is that as they have made advances on the ground, the Syrian armed opposition is now probably going to be a lot harder to extract concessions from. So going forward, I noticed that the new United Nations Special Envoy, Stefan de Mistura, with whom I worked in Iraq, and he's very capable, he doesn't think they can get to a conference anytime soon, a Geneva 3, if you will, Paul. Stefan suggested instead establishment of some working groups between Syrians, among Syrians, on both sides, to discuss things such as security, political transition, refugees, and reconstruction. Topics which all Syrians are concerned about on both sides of the conflict, but which don't involve an actual political negotiation to set up some kind of new system or new structures. That, I think, is a good way forward. But I think at the same time, it's more important than ever, given that Turkey, Saudi Arabia, Qatar are clearly helping the Syrian armed opposition more than they were, say, a year ago. It's really important to get back on the same page with them, with the goal of eventually getting to a negotiation, that a military victory probably is still some time away, even if it's not impossible to imagine now. But it would be better to negotiate a deal. But that means that the secretary is going to have to be back on airplanes or inviting counterparts to Washington to talk specifically about Syria. So reinforce, intensify discussions with Riyadh, with Doha, with Ankara about what's going on the ground. There's no harm in talking to the Russians, and they made some progress with the Russians in terms of getting the Russians to agree to a United Nations Security Council resolution, setting up an investigative team to determine who is dropping chemical weapons now on the battlefields in Syria. The Russians were refusing that for a long time. So the fact that the Russians have agreed that's a good step. And so more engagement with the Russians, but without any expectations of breakthroughs. This is a time instead to manage allies, to get in sync for the day when we can see some light on the Iranian and Russian side and get to a table.
Well, thanks a lot. Let us now turn to the audience. Brief questions or comments, if you can say who the question is directed to. And as you start, introduce yourself. I will start with the lady in the back. The microphone is, there you go. I'll take a few questions in a row. Go ahead.
Hi, thank you. My question is for Ambassador Ford.
Please introduce yourself.
My name is Maha Armush. I work for the State Department. I'm actually Syrian-American. So my question for Ambassador Ford, regarding Syria and Iran, it has been said that Iran really runs the show in Syria, or at least runs the regime. And so there have been critics who have said that Iran will use this deal to funnel lots of money and arms and more fighters into the conflict on the regime side. And I wanted to know your thoughts on that.
Thank you. Somebody from this wing of the room, sir? Guy, gentleman in the second row.
Peter Humphrey, intel analyst and former diplomat. I wanted to ask Dr. Tol, MIT has learned that some Turks have joined Daesh. And I wonder if that's a big factor in why Turkey has finally decided to declare war on ISIS, or was it strictly the bombing in Suruç?
Thank you. Gentlemen, David here in the front.
David Mack from the Middle East Institute. I've got a question for both Tom Lippman and Bob Ford. Do you think an Iranian deal will make a rapprochement between Riyadh and Baghdad more likely or less likely?
Thanks, David. The gentleman right there. I know there are a lot of hands. I'll try to get to them. Yep. Go ahead, John.
John Duke Anthony, a question for any of them. Regarding whether the GCC countries need the U.S. more than the U.S. needs them, this is mixed. The GCC countries are key to 22 Arab countries for leadership, 57 Islamic countries for leadership. Two, with regard to Islam, they are the epicenter of prayer and pilgrimage of faith and spiritual devotion for more than a quarter of humanity. That's important for us. Three, we have 80 years of investment in Saudi Arabia and vice versa. We're not about to turn our back on that. Fourth, with regard to Shia, Saudi Arabia's had good relations, better than bad relations, with Iran, with Yemen, with Syria, and with Lebanon than it's had the negative ones that were implied here. And lastly, with regard to geography, Saudi Arabia alone is a continent more than a country with 13 neighbors there. And on the military aspect, yeah, last year they did have 130,000 troops that had joint maneuvers. That's larger than any of the exercises they've had in history. And the issue of whether they're unified or not is, I don't think, laced with any profundity. The European Union is not unified on questions like the euro, a rather basic question, or with regard to Greece and a number of other issues. So I think we do need them immensely. They need us immensely. And the implication that one needs the other more than the other, I think, is quite debatable.
Thank you. Gentleman at the very back.
Thank you. My name is Zephyr Desis. I'm an intern at the Rumi Forum. My question is on the future of U.S. and Israel relations, or also the relations between the West and Israel. Firstly, was the ability of the P5 plus one, their ability to reach a deal with Iran, also due to the growing tensions between the U.S. and Israel, and particularly Obama's administration and Netanyahu's? And secondly, what does this deal mean for the future of their relations? Thank you.
Thank you. Let me go back to the panel and start with Robert in the reverse order.
So in answer to your Maha's question, it's very difficult for me to imagine that in the short term, the Iranians will not use some small portion of financial resources that they reacquire as part of the sanctions relief over the next year and a half, that they will not use some portion of those resources to help Lebanese Hezbollah, which is really now fighting full out in Syria. The number of Hezbollah casualties now is in the hundreds and is beginning to approach the number of Hezbollah casualties from the 2006 war with Israel. And that they would also use some of those resources to shore up the Assad government, both economically in terms of economic assistance, but also in terms of war material. And that could be both material supplies, but it could also be paying salaries of Shia fighters that they recruit from countries like Pakistan and Afghanistan and Iraq to go and fight in Syria. I would recommend to you a report that the Washington Institute put out about 2 weeks ago about the casualties among expatriate Shia in Syria. Hundreds have been killed in the last year and a half. So, and that's because of the Iranians. And I would expect the Iranians, if you take what Zarif said at his word during his visit to the Gulf last week, that they were going to stay on and they were going to double down. I think that's the least they're going to do. I think the prospect of sanctions relief for Iran means that there will likely be an increase in fighting in Syria in the short and medium term.
Thank you, Robert. Gönül?
In response to the question on why Turkey finally joined the anti-Islamic State coalition, I think the bombing in Suruç on July 20th, it was a turning point. There were 32 people who got killed, and Turkey could not not respond, especially at a time when there is a potential early elections. Turkey's Syria policy, the government's Syria policy, is already very unpopular. So Turkey had to respond. But I think there was an agreement cut between the U.S. and Turkey before the Suruç bombing. So bombing almost became a face-saving way for Turkey to join the anti-Islamic camp. And yet you're right. I mean, Turkey is quite vulnerable. There are now 1,300 Turkish nationals fighting in Syria for the Islamic State. And there are well-established Salafi networks in major Turkish towns. So I think Turkey, yes, woke up to the reality that in fact the Islamic State poses a more direct and bigger challenge than it does to the U.S. Shares a long border with Syria, and there are 2 million Syrian refugees. But I think the main reason is, again, the Kurds. Turkey has been quite uncomfortable with the U.S. decision to airdrop weapons to the PYD in Kobani. And Turkey decided to open the Incirlik Air Base. And in return, it asked for the U.S. to establish a safe zone within Syria. And that is a way of, and the safe zone is right in the middle of, there are three different Kurdish enclaves in northern Syria. And with the fall of Tel Abyad, the Kurds managed to link up those two. So Turkey has been worried that the Kurds are now forming a Kurdish corridor, which could have access to the Mediterranean. And that's a nightmare for Turkey. So Turkey decided that if it can convince the Americans to establish a safe zone in between those two Kurdish enclaves, then it could prevent the Kurds from linking up those enclaves. And that was the deal. So that was the condition. That's how Turkey decided to open the Incirlik Air Base. So as a short answer, yes, Turkey has realized that it's vulnerable. But on the other hand, the Kurdish question, I think, played a larger role in Turkey's decision.
Thanks, Gunnar. Tom?
In response to Ambassador Mack's question about relations between Saudi Arabia and Iraq, I'm always hesitant to get into this in a room full of people who know more about this than I do. But for those of you who haven't followed this, this cat has a very long tail, going back to the fact that when when Maliki was running for prime minister, The Saudis openly backed his opponent, his principal opponent, Iyad Alawi, although Iyad Alawi was himself a Shia. He was a more secular Shia. And there was no possibility that Saudi Arabia and Iraq were going to come back together as long as Alawi was prime minister of Iraq. Now under Abadi, there have been some signs of what I would call movement. That is to say, about a few months ago, probably in the late spring, the Saudis finally, for the first time in many, many years, designated a resident ambassador to go to Baghdad and represent Saudi Arabia. The chosen person was a military intelligence officer last seen in Beirut. Now, thanks to Phoebe Marr, I had the pleasure sometime last year of meeting a career Iraqi diplomat who had just retired. His last post was Iraq's ambassador in Saudi Arabia. So Saudi Arabia was in a position where Iraq had an ambassador in Saudi Arabia, but they didn't have one in Baghdad. Saudi Arabia had an ambassador in Tehran, but didn't have one in Baghdad. It didn't make any sense, but King Abdullah was immovable on this subject. I think now the Saudis are less immovable, but at the same time, remember that along the border between Saudi Arabia and Iraq, they're building a fence that Donald Trump would be proud of.
Thanks. Alex, they might not have been direct questions, but anything you'd like to respond to in the questioning?
I just want to clarify the point I made about the Shias and Saudi Arabia. The argument that the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia is going against the Shias is one that the hardliners in Tehran are putting forward. That's not one necessarily that, you know, the mainstream Islamic Republic of Iran subscribes to. And even if they did, the likes of Ayatollah Rafsanjani, who is the godfather of the Rouhani camp, still making the argument on a daily basis in this case, we made it back in the 1990s. I mean, Iran could, after the very nasty 1980s when Saudi Arabia backed Saddam Hussein, found it in itself to go and reach out to Saudi Arabia by the early 1990s. If they could do it then, why can't they repeat the same experiment? The argument being Saudi Arabia is simply too much of a opponent, a rival in the context of what Iran is trying to do regionally and globally to sort of be ignored. Again, I want to emphasize, one of the very few handful of countries that Rouhani mentioned in his election campaign in 2013, where there was a need in his mind to really make some serious change, was Saudi Arabia. You could perhaps, if we want to be playing the game of wishful thinking, say he's been busy the last 2 years with a nuclear issue, he hasn't come around to it. But now this nuclear deal is done, hopefully he can turn to Saudi Arabia. Again, it's going to be a two-way street. There will be compromises made on both sides, but I would hope if they did go down that path, that would certainly be good news for the region.
Thank you. I know maybe not all aspects of the questions were answered. You might want to corner some of the people after the talk is over. We have a few more minutes left. Let me start with the gentleman here and then move right a bit quickly because our time is limited. Gentleman right in the front here.
Thanks very much. My name is Tyler Thompson with United for a Free Syria. So over a year ago, U.S. government officials quietly asked opposition groups whether they would accept Iran as a security guarantor in Syria. Presumably that includes its constellation of non-state fighting groups, outlaw Iraq. Post-nuke deal, we only see this outcome as more likely. Fighters will tell you that the U.S. has already revealed its alliance with Iran on the Syrian battlefield. So, Ambassador Ford, you mentioned that the U.S. needs to keep an arm's length from these groups in Iraq, but in Syria, we still support groups that directly fight against the Iranian-backed fighters. So if the U.S. were to suddenly announce cooperation with Iran on Syria, should the Syrian opposition see this finally as the end of even rhetorical support from the United States?
Thanks, Tyler. I'll turn to the extreme right. Alan?
Thank you. Alan Kieswetter with the Middle East Institute. The discussion today has been premised on the fact or on the assumption that the Iran deal survives congressional scrutiny. So what are the regional dynamics, the regional ramifications if the Congress kills the deal?
You had to throw that in the last 2 minutes.
Well, can we have another hour and a half?
No. Let me go to the back there, Michael. Last row or row before last.
Thank you. Michael Hudson from Georgetown University. I didn't hear a lot of focus on ISIS and its associated groups. And I was wondering, this is mainly for Ambassador Ford, but others might respond. And I wasn't, is there a kind of a tacit sense that ISIS is on the defensive and will wither away? Or on the contrary, is there some reason to think that ISIS and the associated groups are offensive, that they have all sorts of possibilities, not just in Syria and Iraq, but in other neighboring places?
Thank you. The lady in the third row. Third row from here. Yes, ma'am. The microphone is coming your way.
I'm Parveen Fairchild. I'm from Iran, and I've been married to an American diplomat for close to 50 years. We've served in Middle East and Africa. And my question is that since Israel or Israeli lobby, which both to me seems the same, they're trying to kill this deal, I wish somebody would have been on this panel to explain to us what the hell is going on.
I'm going to have to cut it at that. I know a lot of people really wanted to ask more. I'm sorry, but the constraints of time. Let me start with you, Alex, and throwing out the possibility that you sort of hinted at. If the Congress, well, particularly if there's actually a veto-proof opposition, if it really falls through, what do you think a scenario would look like in Iran?
From Ayatollah Khamenei's point of view, that's not a bad place to be because sanctions are already pretty much crumbling. Post-Ukraine, Russia suddenly makes more overtures to the Iranians, and the Iranians are considering Russia in a more serious manner than probably haven't ever done, given the history of suspicion between Iran and the Russian Empire. So, I mean, what basically that does for Khamenei, who has arguably always had the much narrower focus in terms of, you know, what is it going to be at the end of this deal? If you take Khamenei to be this, let's go with the cliche, transactional guy, he just wanted to have the sanctions removed, well, an American walking away from this deal, basically what it does is brings down international sanctions regime against Iran. So again, Khamenei couldn't care less about U.S. sanctions. On his part, he couldn't care less. They've dealt with U.S. sanctions for three decades. What he has been suffering from are these international sanctions, which tightened only really since summer 2012. So I think, you know, from his perspective, he doesn't have to worry too much. Obviously, the so-called Rouhani camp with a much bigger economic agenda and coming back to the international mainstream, they would not be too happy because that really is going to put the brakes on from their perspective.
Thank you, Alex. Tom, nobody's commented on Israel. There was a question in the first round, a question in the second round. Any thoughts on that?
I'm sorry, you wanted me to talk about Israel?
No, I'm wondering, there are a few questions about how Israel and the nuclear deal.
Well, look, in the unthinkable event that the nuclear deal is not, does not survive in Congress, right? I haven't read one word of useful commentary from any outfit in the Gulf about that possibility, because it's unthinkable. And also because their governments, having accepted it, they're not about to challenge it at this point. But the answer to that question might lie more with Israel than it does with the members of the GCC and the Gulf states. They now have to take us at our word that whatever else happens, Iran will not be permitted to get a nuclear weapon. How we would prevent that, that'd be up to us in the absence of this agreement. But what would happen if the Israelis were to decide that the failure of this deal then meant that they had to take some kind of unilateral military action? The consequences of that would be enormous, but in my opinion, almost entirely unpredictable.
Thank you, Tom. Gönül, anything from this round of questions you want to respond to before getting to Robert?
I can take the question on whether the Islamic State whether the Islamic State is in retreat in Turkey. I think it is recruiting more and more from Turkey. And it's, I think, relatively harder for the Islamic State to cross the border. Now Turkey stepped up border protection and working with the European countries to stem the flow of foreign jihadis. But I think right now Turkey, the Islamic State, is its hand is stronger in Turkey. And now that the Turkish government decided to wage a simultaneous war against the PKK. So just last week, it issued a threat. The Islamic State issued a threat threatening Turkey that it would be very easy to destabilize Turkey if Turkey fully joins the fight against the Islamic State. It would just take a bomb. That was what the statement said. It would just take a bomb in a Turkish resort. So I think it is in a stronger position in Turkey, but I don't know how that would translate for the ISIS activities in Syria.
Thanks, Gönül. Robert.
In answer to Professor Hudson's question about the Islamic State, I think in Iraq they generally are on the defensive, but in Diyala, in Saladin provinces, and also in Anbar. In Syria, they're on the defense in the northwest, up in Hasakeh province. They've actually had to fall back quite a bit, but they're on the offense in other parts of the country, in the center, pushing towards the west. They're actually getting fairly close to northern suburbs of Damascus, although there's plenty of fight left in regime units around Damascus. And I haven't talked about the Islamic State so much directly, Professor Hudson, simply because I see no way to manage the ISIS challenge, the Islamic State challenge, without having unity governments in both countries. I don't think the United States is going to put tens of thousands of combat troops on the ground in Syria and Iraq. I certainly hope not, having spent 5 years in Iraq trying to get troops out of there. And I don't think any foreign state, including Iran, is willing to commit tens of thousands of troops. And these countries are big enough, and the space that the Islamic State occupies is so big, it will take tens of thousands of troops. So the real question to me is, can these two very broken political entities find ways to achieve national unity and rally more people into the Islamic State fight? Abadi, I think, on the Iraq side is trying to do that, but Iranian-backed militias have really put some wrenches into his efforts. And on the Syrian side, I see no sign that Bashar al-Assad is more interested in the fight against the Islamic State than in preservation of his family's hold on power.
Thank you, and our time is up. This has been really an excellent, very rich panel on a topic that will continue to unfold. Please join me in thanking my colleagues.